I play the part of Jamie Sullivan, who's kind of the plain Jane in town, not concerned with the typical things that a regular 17-year-old would be. I wouldn't say she's enlightened, but she's definitely... She's not concerned with the trivial things that the people in school that surround her are kind of concerned with. But I am put in all these situations at school with this boy, Landon, who I've been in school with for years, but never really been friends with. He's kind of in a different crowd than I am. And I see him at church. We're put in the school, like, drama program and stuff together. And because of that, I really see that he is deep down a really good person, kind of unbeknownst to him and the people around him. And I kind of prove that to him and show him what a great person he is. And throughout all of that, we kind of start to fall in love. Landon and Jamie are put in these situations where obviously they have to meet and become in contact with each other. And I think Jamie does see the good in Landon at first and is kind of sketchy a little bit because she's seen him at school. She's never been friends with him. She sees the type of person that he portrays himself to be and the type of people he hangs out with. So I think she's a little bit uneasy at first about becoming such fast friends with him. But she kind of fools him a little bit and then gets her feelings hurt because she tries to approach him at school when he's surrounded by his friends. And of course, he acts like the jerky person that he's always acted towards her as. Just about everybody's opposed to Landon going with Jamie. All of his friends, obviously. Dude, what's up with that? She's the daughter of the minister. She's the outcast at school. Nobody talks to her. She talks to nobody. She's not involved in any of the things that we like to do. She's always going to church. She's tutoring kids on the weekends for fun. So definitely all of his friends, and I think even his mother at one point, just because she knows what type of person Landon is and who his friends are and who's hanging out with and what he's doing on the weekends, and just doesn't want her son to be involved with, you know, the town, I guess, church kid. It just comes so unexpectedly, but it's something so deep down inside that Jamie, you know that Jamie really wants. You can't be 17 and not live your life without having been loved or to have just loved another person. So I think it makes it all the more special just because she didn't expect it and thought she didn't want it. But when it came and she really started to feel it, you knew that's really what she wanted for the rest of her life, just to have that feeling. I think the challenging thing at 17 about playing romance and love is it's something that I'm not exactly 100% experienced in yet. But the cool thing about this story is I'm just starting to fall in love. It's nothing that I've had to be experienced in yet. Obviously, Jamie has never had a boyfriend. She's never kissed a boy. So it's good, I think, in that sense to have that type of innocence on screen, because it's very true in life. The great thing about this film that I think will excite audiences is it's not a typical teen movie. I think this is a wonderful movie for you to go see with your parents, especially moms. There are so many adults out there who have read this book and who've fallen in love with this book that are gonna feel the exact same way about the film. And for people my age, I just feel like it's such a wonderful option to have out in theaters amongst so many other teen movies that are talking about the same thing and rehashing the same subjects that we as teens live every single day of our life. So I don't know. It's different to me, and it's wonderful. It's something that you're actually gonna walk out of the theater having felt something and maybe learned something.
I basically play the character of Landon Carter, who is the small town hero, basically, who has his group of popular friends, and they probably all know that they're not going to go anywhere after high school or be much of a success. And Jamie Sullivan is, who's played by Mandy Moore, is basically the nerd in the school, the recluse. And you never would have thought that my character would actually ever fall for her, but she actually teaches me a lot about life, what to do with my life, as well as I try to help her out. And it's just, in the end, it's an improbable love story. We're in different groups, you know, it's high school. You know, social groups are, you know, quote unquote, important. You know, you even though they aren't, you know, kids unfortunately think so. I'm in the popular group. She's not. She's the reverend's daughter. She wears the same sweater all the time. She reads the Bible. So consequently, we'd make, you know, fun of her. So when we meet, I'm not interested in all. We're all, most people are basically appalled by her. And I start to slowly get intrigued by her, by some of the things she says and some of the things that I actually understand that she understands. She was just different, and it was weird to us. She was too into God and too into all those things, and we didn't know if we were into that. And but in the movie, the first time you see me, Landon, actually see her, it's more of like, oh, great, you know, there she is again. There's the freak again. And but I sense something in her. I've always sensed something in her. And it takes a serious car accident that I get into and being put on probation at school to actually having her help me with these lines that I have to learn for this school play that brings it out of me. I get the part to play a character in this play in which she's going to be in. And I am, you know, my character is a horrible actor, and I need the help. And she doesn't want the play to bottom up. So she offers her help, and the time we spend together through that, I start to fall for her, basically. For my mom, it's be careful, she's the reverend's daughter. You know, she knows me, and she knows probably the people I've been out with in the past, and this is not that type of girl. And, you know, for my friends, it's what the heck do you think you're doing? And one of the friends is actually my ex-girlfriend, who keeps trying to come back to me, but I end up pushing her away. They all just can't believe it because we've all grown up with this girl. It's like dating the school nerd all of a sudden and being dead serious about it. They just don't grasp it. And thankfully, in the end, the true friends understand what I'm talking about and they see what I see in her and they help me out. Mandy's father, he knows about me too. And he sees me in church every Sunday, and he knows I'm one of the punks, and he knows I got in this, I hurt this kid accidentally, daring him to do something, and I get in a car accident after that, and he, you know, everybody in the town knows these things. They don't need a school paper or a newspaper to figure them out, and, I mean, he's, would probably turn in his grave thinking that she would actually have an interest in me. But in the end, he actually ends up being the biggest help for me, because he sees that I care about her so much, and he sees that I'm worried about her and that I want to take care of her, and he knows I'm not leaving. So at that point, he has to give in, you know, and, you know, those scenes were a lot of fun.
The story of a young girl whose love transforms a bad boy, and it's, that's the plot. It's about a high school ruffian who falls in love with the daughter of a minister that I play. And her goodness transforms him. That sounds very corny, but it's not. And on a deeper level, it's kind of how when tragedy occurs, it washes everybody's eyes. Everybody gets to look at the same old world in a different way and is changed by it. Mandy, who I didn't really know, but the daughters of my close friend has never cared that I've worked with Sharon Stone or Dustin Hoffman or Hugh Grant or anything, but when she heard I was working with Mandy Moore, suddenly I was worth something. So she was a much bigger personality than I knew, and she's completely devoid of attitude. She's innocent without being naive. She travels with her family. She's just seems good-hearted. She's very professional. She's easy and fun to work with. I mean, I kid around with everybody on the set, and we have a good time.
Hey, what's up? I am Mandy Moore, and spend a day on the set with me on my new film, A Walk to Remember. Hey, what's up? I am Mandy Moore, and welcome to the set of my new film, A Walk to Remember. And if you'd like to follow me, you can come see what a day in the life is like. Come on. We are in hair and makeup right now. We just came back from rehearsal. We went to set and rehearsed with Adam and Julio and got all the camera shots down and got our lines down and stuff like that. So I finish hair, I scoot down the trailer to makeup, then I run back to my trailer and get into my clothes and run to set. This is JoJo and she's like the most important person. No,
it's just basically making her look dowdy, you know, taking away everything pretty, because even though Jamie is pretty, she's simple. She doesn't get into fixing her hair or wearing the best clothes.
It's like a ponytail every day, right?
Ponytail every day. And we can't tell you when it changes because we'll probably get away from it.
Let me grab that. You want to leave it here?
Jeff here does my makeup every morning. And basically we go ultra pale, right?
Yep.
Pretty pale and no makeup.
Nope. Very unglamorous look, this one.
Very unglamorous look for me.
It's all good.
We are getting ready to shoot the first scene of the day. And it's just me opening and closing the door, a tiny bit of dialogue, and it's gonna be pretty easy. This is Al.
Hey, how's everybody in their living rooms?
What's up?
Matthew.
Hey, what's up?
Okay, ready here.
And they're like, cool. That's Adam Shankman. The Adam Shankman.
The Adam, wedding planner, the man with the master plan, Shankman. Right over here. Adam Cool Breeze Shankman. He is modeling from Kmart's new Dukes of Hazzard line, special plaid shirt, and a Fruit of the Loom, or BBD, t-shirt. Yes, look, as Adam graces the runway. You gotta do the watch thing, Adam. Do the watch pose. Yes, he is. Yes, he is.
This is the lunch line.
We're getting our crew to sit down for lunch. We sit with everybody, the crew, the cast, and we eat. We eat. You can't see what I get to eat because I think my parents will be upset with me that I'm not eating healthy. Hi, Pam. Do you have fun?
Yeah.
Good.
Ooh. That's a good on-camera reaction.
Yeah, you can film my plate, because I won't be eating very much of anything. At all. What is this?
Rice is good.
What is this?
Okay. Plus, you give me like a creepy.
This is my teacher, Stephanie.
Hi. How are you?
And we're just actually reading about Jack London, the author. And we just read all about him and his struggles in the Yukon. And we're about to read one of his stories called To Build a Fire. But this is what we basically do. Anytime during the day when we have a free break, I don't get to go relax in the trailer. I usually have to come visit Miss Stephanie.
I'm always struggling to get my time. She has to have 3 hours a day. That's an average of 3 hours a day. So some days we may do 4 hours, and some days we may do 2 hours, and some days we may do 1 hour. But
and
we
some
do
days
get 15
we may
hours
do
a week.
No hours, but yeah. we have to have 15 hours a week.
15 a week to fulfill
so
the
it's
SAG
really
requirements.
Hard. That's a wrap. Thank you guys so much for hanging out with me today on set, and be sure to check out my new film, A Walk to Remember. Bye.